My topic is the poetry of Rumi and Iranian cinema. Admittedly, this is a very complex topic for the simple reason that Rumi lived in the 13th century and modern Iranian cinema is a 20th century product. So this distance in time creates all kinds of problems. So it's a very, very challenging task. And the other is, one can well raise the question, what visible connection is there between religious mystical poetry of Rumi and the sort of modern technology-based cinema of Iran? So I'll try to make some connection. You may or may not be convinced by what I say. But in any case, the fact is that Iran cinema has become an object of global fascination. The very fact that the three panelists on this discussion speak English in three different accents is itself emblematic of that. I speak English in a Sri Lankan accent, my friend Shaheen speaks in an Iranian accent, and Anne speaks in an Australian accent. So this itself shows the kind of universal product that it has come to be. Anyway, there are two limitations to my talk. The first is the limitation of time. So in 20 minutes, I'm going to cover a very broad topic. The second is, I'm working through translations. This is a very, very risky business. As Robert Frost once said, poetry is what gets lost in translation. So here I'm going to talk about Rumi's poetry through translation. So it's very tricky, but still that has not prevented me from expressing my opinion on the subject anyway. So these two limitations are, I think, you've got to keep in mind. Okay, now the first important point that you've got to keep in mind is that Rumi is one of the most important Persian poets. Rumi, Hafez, and Omar Khayyam are very well known, not only in Iran, but outside as well. There are many, many English translations of their work. He lived for 67 years, from 2007 to 2073. And he wrote in essentially, not solely, but essentially in a form called ghazals, right? I mean, these are kind of mystical, lyrical verse that were extremely popular not only in Iran, it really started somewhere in the 6th century in Arabic culture, but reached zenith, peak, in the 12th century, 13th century in Iran. But the important fact is that Westerners are practicing this art form. Our own poet laureate from Hawaii, W.S. Merwin, who lives in Maui, is a wonderful practitioner of this art. So is Adrian Rich, so is Robert Bly, and many other distinguished American poets. So this is an art form that lends itself to diverse cultural inflections. So, but still, Rumi was a poet who actually manifested great talent in this form. So he wrote in this form, which is basically a kind of mystical, lyrical, melancholic form. And the closest that I can think of in the Anglo-American tradition, here I'm taking a risk, is William Blake. In many ways, I think William Blake touches on some of these issues. For instance, in a poem like the Sick Rose, O Rose, thou art sick. The invisible worm that flies in the night in the howling storm has found thy bed of crimson joy, and his secret desire thy life destroys. So, I mean, you know, you get the very simple sort of the rose, but builds a highly complex symbolic world. This is precisely what Rumi does. He selects simple objects, the rose, the sea, the sun, the moon, the nightingale. All these carry heavy freights of symbolic meaning, but he constructs very imaginative worlds, right? Like Blake. Now, this Blake's poem is very simple on the surface, but it's full of sexual symbolism, as you can see. So that it's a very, very complex mode of poetic discourse, right? So the closest I can think of is Blake. So when you think of Rumi, think of a poet like Blake. Of course, five centuries separate them. He's from the 13th century. Blake was born in the 18th century and came to maturity in the early 19th. But still, I think it's important to keep in mind. Now, what are some of the central themes that Rumi explored in his poetry? So before I do that, let me just, some of you may not be familiar with his work, so let me just read one poem so that you get a sense of what the kind of attitude to life and music and representational strategies that he plays. It's called Music and Silence. This is a very important theme for him, silence. Lover's union is here, the meeting we have wanted, the fire, the joy, like sadness and any fear of death, leave the room. The sun's glory come back, winds shake our bells. We are counters in your hand, passing easily through. Music begins, your silence deepens that. Were you to put words with that, we would not survive the song, right? If you were going to put words to that, the song won't survive, right? So he's playing this on the idea of speech and silence. This is quite important, right? So some of his most important themes were religion, God, love, love both divine and mundane. And in a sense, in his poetry, there are two sides of the same coin, right? So love. The idea of separation. And the separation, of course, immediately triggers the idea of union. So separation and union. And then, of course, silence. The other day when we talked about, when I presented some aspect of this talk, Sarah raised a very important question, whether, you know, silence, how does silence operate in poetry and what's the function in silence in Rumi's poetry and so on. These are very, very important questions. So he plays on this antithesis between speech and silence, which I refer to later. Okay, so he talks, he selects very common objects from life, sun, but then he invests that with symbolic meaning. For him, the sun is both a teacher and a guide. He takes the concept of the moon, the object of the moon, but the moon becomes a symbol of tranquility and beauty. He selects the sea becomes an emblem of life. Similarly, the nightingale becomes an emblem of the soul, and the rose, very commonly found in his poetry, very often references God, right? So he takes simple objects, but invests them with deep symbolic and religious and metaphysical meaning. The important point about Rumi's poetry, it seems to me, is that his is a poetry of metaphysics, but it is also metaphysics of poetry, right? If you get the chiasmus I'm drawing, the chiasmatic relation I'm establishing. It's a poetry of mysticism, but also it deals with the mysticism of poetry. Poetry of metaphysics, but metaphysics of poetry. That's precisely what you find in a poet like Blake, it seems to me. So this, I think, you got to keep in mind. So he's a very important, interesting poet. He's overtly simple, but his poetry carries various levels of significance, right? So keep that in mind. Now that's Rumi, very important poet, widely translated into English, and there are many, many translations in English, some done by very eminent American poets, right? So it's very important. Okay. The filmmaker that I have selected for analysis is Abbas Kiarostami, that Shaheen referred to earlier. In my judgment, he's the most important Iranian filmmaker today, right? No less a person than Jean-Luc Godard, the French director, said, film starts with D.W. Griffith and ends with Abbas Kiarostami. I mean, that statement is a supreme tribute to the talent of Kiarostami, because some would claim film starts with Griffith and ends with Jean-Luc Godard, right? So that, I mean, for this to have been made by Jean-Luc Godard is itself a tribute to, I think, his indubitable talent. So, okay. And another example of the importance of Kiarostami is, those of you who are into cultural theory, I don't want to get too much into cultural theory here, because, you know, there's a very important French theorist called Jean-Luc Nancy, N-A-N-C-Y, cutting-edge theorist, one of the leading philosophers in Paris, right? He wrote a book on cinema called The Evidence of Cinema. It's published in French, but I think there are English translations now. In that book, right, he builds a theory, very complex theory of cinema, but it is not built on European filmmakers. It's not built on an American filmmakers. It's built on the work of the Iranian filmmaker Abbas Kiarostami, right? His entire theoretical edifice depends on three films made by Kiarostami. So that itself shows the importance of Kiarostami as a filmmaker, right? Extremely important. So against this background, I've given you some sense of the importance of Rumi as a poet, and then I've mentioned the importance of Kiarostami. My point is, I'm trying to argue that there is a connection which has not been made by most critics that I know between Rumi and Kiarostami. There have been some attempts sort of to point out, yes, there's mysticism, there's religious sensibility. But I'm arguing at a much more fundamental, to use a technical term, at an ontological level. The very being of cinema has to be understood in terms of Rumi, right? So in other words, you can understand Kiarostami through Rumi, and you can understand Rumi through Kiarostami. So there's a dual interplay that's going on, right? So let me give my reasons for that, right? My first reason is, I would like to argue that Rumi is what I call a meta-poet, or Rumi's poetry is what I call meta-poetry. Now, what is meta-poetry? Meta-poetry is poetry that comments on itself. Whether you write about the nightingale or God or separation, you are also talking about your chosen medium of creative expression, right? His main point is that language is an unreliable guide. It's a limited instrument of communication. He wrote 65,000 verses to point out that silence is more important than speech, right? So in other words, he's pointing out the inherent limitations of language. This is precisely what Kiarostami is trying to do in his films. You know, he's talking about children's world, he's talking about adult world. But the point he's making is, cinema is an inherently limited medium. There's so much that you can do with that, and there's so much that gets left out, right? So therefore, I would argue that Kiarostami's films are a form of meta-cinema. So Rumi is meta-poetry, and Kiarostami is meta-cinema. So that's the first connection that I would like to make. The second is that in the case of Rumi, when you read his poetry, you begin to see that poems evolve through the very construction of the poem. It's not fully formed before he starts writing it. As he starts writing, as he summons imagery, as he invests them with symbolic meaning, the experience begins to unfold in unforeseen direction, right? So the construction takes place within that very effort. It's not something prefabricated. The poem arises through that very effort of poetic construction. The same thing is found in Kiarostami's films. His films take shape as he sort of operates his camera angles and the soundtrack and gets the actors to do whatever he wants, so that there's a construction, processual construction going on as the film unfolds, right? So that's a second very important connection that I would like to establish between Rumi's poetry and Kiarostami's films, and that is the idea of poetic construction or cinematic construction. The third is the notion that both subscribe to a notion of complex simplicity, right? Rumi's poetry is overtly simple, but in point of fact, it's very complex. So it is a kind of complex simplicity that you find in Rumi's poetry. The same thing you find in Kiarostami's films. Let me give one example. One of his early films, Bread and Alley, right? Bread and Alley deals with a young boy who goes to a grocery store, buys a loaf of bread, and as he comes, returns home, he's followed by a dog, right? I mean, so that's the sort of basic story that he's dealing with. Very simple, but the film itself is anything but simple. Right, it's full. He enters into that world. His camera angles say so many different things. So the idea of complex simplicity is shared by both Rumi and by Kiarostami. Right. So that again seems to be a very important aspect. Another is the idea of image. We all know films work through images. That's why they are called movies, moving images. Right. And there has been a sort of philosophers. My friends, like some philosophers in the audience, like Tom Jackson, would obviously know that there are philosophers like Gilles Deleuze, a French philosopher, who's written two classic books on the image in cinema, Cinema 1 and Cinema 2. The first is called Movement Image, the second is called Time Image. The two books deal with the centrality of image in understanding film. So image is very important, right? So what you find in Rumi's poetry is a very interesting approach to imagery. It's very vivid, right? I mean, he has wonderful lines like, the empty trees shake and fail like drunks returning home, right? I mean, wonderful. Or you can say, come out here where roses have opened let us help soul meet the world, right? Simple, but then you begin to understand, I mean, a lot of things going on. The rose, the soul, and the world, are the triangular relationship is what drives his poetry, right? So it's very simple, but it's very, very complex at the same time. So his images perform a number of important functions. To me, there are two very important functions performed by his image. One is it's a way of knowledge production. After all, poetry is a form of knowledge production. It certainly addresses our emotions, but through emotions, it also creates a certain body of knowledge, right? So the images are central in the advancement of that knowledge production. That's one. The second is Rumi's images bear witness to something deeper than what we ordinarily see. So they bear witnesses, they bear evidence. That's precisely what you find in the case of Kiarostami, because his images produce knowledge, right? At the same time, his images bear witness. That's why Jean-Luc Nancy selected Kiarostami for his theory of evidence rather than any other filmmaker, because he felt Kiarostami's images carry this evidence, right? And films like Life and Nothing More, you know, which deals with the Iranian earthquake and what happened after that and so on, Nancy analyzes in great detail to establish the point that his images bear witness. They are carriers of evidence, right? So this is shared by both Rumi and Kiarostami. So that, again, I think is an important aspect. So these are some common features which, to the best of my knowledge, no one has said before. I mean, maybe someone has said that, I don't know. But certainly, I mean, these are some that occurred to me as I began to reflect on this. So having said this, I want to take one step further and say, you know, if, I'm being very presumptuous here, but if sort of Kiarostami is willing to pursue this line, he might end up with a typical Persian poetics of cinema, right? That's what we are all trying to do, right? Let's just take the Asian situation, right? Film as an art form was introduced to Asia, you know, some decades ago. It's not a native art form, it came from the West. But very quickly, it took root in the soil and the consciousness of the people. Why was it so easy to make this connection? The reason is, some of the more talented filmmakers were able to establish a connection between their past and the newly imported form of cinema. Let me give some examples. Yasujiro Ozu, the great Japanese filmmaker, drew heavily on Zen Buddhism, right? I mean, if you take Tokyo Monogatari, right, Tokyo Story, right, you begin to understand how central sort of the past, the Zen culture is. Or if you take a Chinese filmmaker like Chen Kai-ge, right, Yellow Earth, he draws on Chinese classical painting. That's this kind of relationship he establishes between tiny human beings and these vast rolling mountains in that, right? That's Chinese painting. Or if you take a Korean film like Im Kwon-taek's Seopyeonji, which is based on Korean traditional music, Pansari music, right? Or if you take an Indian filmmaker like Ritvik Ghatak, his film, it has a kind of Shakespearean title, Cloud-Capped Stars, which comes from Shakespeare, of course, he draws on the traditional Hindu visual registers, right? So all these filmmakers have drawn on their past, and similarly, Iranian filmmakers have drawn on their past, but in this case, as Shaheen also pointed out, on poetry, right? So therefore, poetry is very important. For instance, in at least two of Kiarostami's films that I can recall, Where's My Friend's Home and The Wind Will Carry Us, Omar Khayyam is referenced, right? Similarly, I think there is a connection that can be established between Rumi and Kiarostami in terms of going back to the past and drawing on that. So that's one very important aspect. Another is, in one of his interviews, Kiarostami had used two very important terms which I think are central to understand his cinematic endeavor. The two terms are cosmic shot and lyrical abstraction. Let me explain what this means. You know, if you are familiar with Kiarostami's films, he uses this sort of long cosmic shot in many of his films. Let me give one example. In the film through the olive trees at the end. You know, it's a kind of love story. There's a young man and a young girl, and the young man, of course, is deeply interested in this girl, and her parents have died after the earthquake, and she's living with the grandmother, and the grandmother would have none of it, so that, you know, they cannot get married. But the last sequence is the young boy and the girl, they are just walking through the olive trees, and you have this long cosmic shot, right? But this is very important, I'll explain later, to the creation of a kind of Persian poetics of cinema, because something unique is happening here, right, which is not commonly found. I'll explain what that is. So this cosmic shot, and the other is what he calls lyrical abstraction, right? In fact, these two terms can be used very productively to understand Rumi, because Rumi uses constantly lyrical abstractions, because in his love poetry, it's not specificity that matters as the nature of being iconic, right? So it's the iconic nature that is important. The abstraction, the lyrical abstraction, I think that's crucial. So these two terms that Kiarostami uses can be equally validly applied to Rumi, right? The cosmic shot and the lyrical abstraction. So that's another connection. Then a third is the whole idea of body, right? Now, you saw Shahin's early examples from early Iranian cinema. There's a great degree of freedom in representing the body. But things have changed after the Iran Revolution, right? You've got to be very careful in how you represent the body, especially the female body. An aesthetic of modesty has appeared in Iranian cinema, right? It's not a bad thing. I mean, people would say, well, the freedom has been curtailed. But maybe the limitation can be turned into an advantage. That's what Shakespeare did, right? In Shakespeare's age, women couldn't play the act on the stage, right? So what did Shakespeare do? He turned that into an advantage. So in many of his plays, you get, you know, men acting women's roles and women acting men's roles. So it's a way that you turn limitations into positive advantages as an index of an artist's talent. And Kiarostami rose to the occasion. He sort of saw this limitation and made that into an enabling condition of cinematic advancement, right? So in his films, there's a kind of poetics of the body. It's not the specificity of the body that's important, but it's the idea of bodiness, right? That's exactly what you find in Rumi's poetry. Rumi is not talking about a specific woman or a specific man. He's talking of human beings as icons, right? So that, I think, is quite important if you are to develop a poetics of Persian cinema. It seems to me that's what he's trying to do, as indeed other filmmakers like some years ago, Mehruji, and in more recent times, Makhmalbaf, both have sort of tried to create an indigenous poetics of cinema. So this, it seems to me, as an important point that one has to keep in mind. A famous Argentinian film critic called Kiarostami's films cinema of subtraction, cinema of subtraction. What he meant by that is you have this complexity, but given the contemporary Islamic and Iranian culture, you cannot represent in its totality. Certain subtractions have to be made, right? Some things have to be subtracted, some things have to be deleted. So therefore he called it cinema of subtraction. But it seems to me that he is only telling the half the story. It seems to me that Kiarostami film is also cinema of addition, right? How does that operate? It's true that he has to operate within this modern Islamic culture, which doesn't allow certain kinds of representation. But that gives an opportunity to invest what he's doing with symbolic meaning. You add symbolic meaning, right? So therefore, it's both a cinema of subtraction and a cinema of addition at the same time. And that's how I read Kiarostami's films. So all these are aspects, at least to my mind, of a kind of effort towards the creation of a Persian poetics of cinema. All Asian filmmakers are trying to do that, as indeed the Hawaiian filmmakers, for instance, at the Academy of Creative Media that Chris Lee started, the idea was to promote indigenous Hawaiian filmmaking, because we still don't have the great Hawaiian film, right? We have films starting with Blue Hawaii and so on, which were total misrepresentations of Hawaii. But we still haven't got the true complex Hawaiian film with the good and the bad and the ugly all represented honestly and sincerely and so on. So we are working towards that. Similarly, Asian filmmakers are working towards an indigenous poetics. Here we can learn something from Iranian cinema, certainly from Kiarostami. Rami. He hasn't achieved it yet, but he certainly, it's my judgment, he's working towards that, because there are certain vital ingredients that one can see in his effort that allows us to create, move towards a kind of indigenous poetics of cinema, right? So once again, just to summarize, but so it's a large topic, and I take a risk because I work through translation. At the same time, I must say I have a connection with Sanskrit. I'm a Sanskritist like Tom. Tom was also a Sanskritist at one stage in his life. So I'm a Sanskritist, so I have that door opened into Persian culture. But even so, I'm working through translations. And the gist of my talk is this, right? That Rumi is a very important poet. Right? I mean, there are lots of translations of his poems, and he's fully worth studying in depth and detail. Right? At the same time, Kiarostami is one of the great masters of modern cinema. I must say, not everyone agrees with my judgment. In Iran, he's a controversial figure. Some love his work. Others say that he is making films for festivals, he's making films for the Western audience, especially the academics and intellectuals in Left Bank Paris, right? That argument has been repeatedly made, and that debate goes on. But with my kind of limited judgment, I think Kiarostami is one of the great masters of modern cinema, right? So, if Rumi is a very important poet, and Kiarostami is one of the great masters of modern cinema, if someone can make this connection, I think that's a very, very important one. And this panel would have achieved a great sort of, done a great service by focusing on this very important problematic. Thank you very much.